This is a reading from the Notebooks by Maria Voltorta, 1943, December the 12th. Jesus says, even the soul most willing to belong to God entirely is subject to being distracted by the needs of existence. It is not necessary to be a slave to them to be distracted by them, but even if you are already so spiritual that you are more soul than body, as long as the flesh robes your soul, as the covering encloses the fruit, you are subject to the exigencies of the flesh. When reduced to that minimum, which I also accepted, they are not a sin, but a duty and an act of prudence. I did not preach the destruction of the flesh through the flesh by a morbid cruelty to it, like that of certain forms of asceticism in use among religious in different parts of the world. I taught you, and showed you by my example, that it is not necessary to be concerned about the flesh, which dies, but about the immortal soul. I taught you not to be afraid of what may kill your bodies, but of what kills your spirits. I taught that if you are given a choice between the preservation of the body and the preservation of the soul, you must always choose what preserves the soul. But I did not teach you merely to torture the flesh out of a mistaken religious interpretation, and much less out of hypocritical religion. In truth, I tell you that, even if you fast with your mouths and then do not fast with your hearts by refusing to do harm to your neighbor with your actions, words, and thoughts as well, your fasting is detestable to me, and means death for your souls, for practices without charity are nothing but a heaping up of stones for the lapidation of your eternal future. As I tell you, do not slay your souls with the actions of the flesh. So I say to you, do not slay your flesh with behavior that is not holy, but simply fanatical. Be holy in spirit, thought, feeling, works, and flesh. How then can you get life not to distract you, and get the soul as your queen, to keep the subject flesh under a dominion where there is no injustice? With love. Love is your teacher, and, like the conductor of an orchestra, directs all your actions, which, like the varied instruments of an orchestra, fuse into a single sound full of harmony that may be a slight melodic phrase, a more complex passage, or even a grandiose symphony, according to your power in loving. The giants of love obtain the full, imposing chorus of a surpassing symphony, where angels and saints join in. They do not see the giants of love still living on the earth, but with a seraphic spirit as different from themselves. The loving ones, when they comprehend that faithful ardor obtains the growth of the lover and makes him or her a giant of love, are already able to sing their melody, over which angels and saints bend, ready to join in. Those willing to love will be able only to repeat a melodic phrase, like a sparrow's call to the sun, delaying and assailing him with its golden rays, for he cannot fly high up like a skylark, celebrating the dawn, to meet the sun, transporting the body, whose weight is cancelled out by desire, beyond his capacities for flight, and his song, beyond his possibilities for withstanding until falling, destroyed by desire, when, having reached the good sought after, they die in rejoicing of fusion with the golden ray. But even that timid, short call, for it is faithful, and is all that creature can give, is blessed by God and protects that being's action from contamination. Who are the giants of love? They are the victim souls. You divide them into victims of justice, victims of expiation, and victims of love. But make no distinctions. The victim is always a victim of love. Who expiates? Why do they expiate? Out of love for their brothers and sisters, for whom they pay the portion of expiation which would correspond to the others, love of one's neighbor pushed to the point of heroism. Who are the victims of justice? To whom do they offer themselves? To God, offended, to offer him comfort in the face of the offense, love of God pushed to the point of heroism. Love is the eternal sacrificer. What immolated God made flesh, and what immolates your flesh and soul, making them similar to Christ the Redeemer. The victim's soul is sure, as if she were already enclosed in my eternal kingdom, of being saved, for her every heartbeat, movement, word, feeling, and action is sanctified by love, which protects her entirely from human contamination. The victim's soul is in prayer, even when not expressing prayer. The victim's soul penetrates into me, and from the center of my heart, which calls her sister, takes and distributes graces and blessings for her brothers and sisters. There are no limitations for my victims. All that is mine is theirs, for they have wanted to offer their being to the eternal sacrificer. The victim soul is extended over an aculeus whose peaks are pain and love, pain over not seeing God loved as their heroism and love has allowed them to see that God should be loved. More than illnesses and misfortunes, they are tormented by the forms of spiritual wretchedness which, like ruins in a country destroyed by an enemy, cover the spirits of their fellows, cancelling out God's impress in them and burying His holy name under the obstruction of sin. More than pain in itself, their pain is to feel their incapacity to reach the perfection of love, their dream, for they would like to give God a gift worthy of His perfection. And if I was fastened to my altar by 3 nails, they also are, for my love, and their pain are the 3 nails keeping them crucified until death, which is nothing but breathing out their spirits onto my breast after having accomplished everything. My love, an ocean of fire which from the height of the heavens rushes upon a soul, and, with the continual arrival of waves of ardor, consumes her as if she were soft wax attacked by a flame. Insatiable hunger which is common to the two who love one another, and Christ wants to devour His creature to make her part of Himself, and the creature wants to breathe God into herself to make Him her life. Everything stops in the face of this dominator who passes by, asserting His rights. Existence, intelligence, and affections open out and become a wing, and love proceeds and enters, for it is the king of all things. The soul then takes the passions of her spouse in love and makes them her own. The treasure of treasures for her is to be martyred day by day for this purpose, and to see light coming back into hearts, and hearts turning to God with the eyes of her spirit, for love converts even without words, and carries away without cords. Love is the force which rules the universe, and love is what saves the world. And not commanders, scientists, or doctors, but the loving are the ones who are able to find the ways for the victories leading to good, tearing away with their burning impetus the satanic chains which make you slaves to the evil one who hates you. And if the love of believers would obtain the miracle of better times, which, by your way of living, you have precluded for yourselves, the love of the victims, which is the love most like perfection of my own love, is what acts as a barrier to the fury swelling from Satan to destroy you in a desperate curse, and opens the gates to forgiveness, fusing them with the fire of their holocaust.